just my guess, I would think that a Dand reader is an action man. The Beano reader, maybe he'll be in the way derogatory. He might be a librarian or an accountant. Or
really, we're quite proud of our jobs. And it's quite a good talking point because it stirs memories in people that we're speaking to.
But would someone believe you if you said, I'm the editor of the Beano? In some of the Fife Miners pubs where I have been known to drink, you might just say I'm in publishing.
Yeah, that's right. It depends on what company you're in.
It's such an unusual job to write the stories for the Dandy and the Beano. Just recently, my wife started to believe it that...
after 14 years
of after that. That's the one, yeah. Well, Helen, I'm the editor of the Dandy. And I look after the comic. I check out the scripts and the artwork and just look after it in general.
And I do the same job on the Beano comic. I've done for the last 3 years.
I worked with him for... few years as his chief sub-editor and have recently escaped from the fold and taken over the Beezer comic during the last 2 months. Again, a similar job to the other gentleman here.
When you look at the two comics, there's not a lot of difference. It's a difference in it's the mood of the comics. The Dandy, going back a long time, has been a more, you might say, a more robust, a more vigorous comic. We go in for a lot of the slapstick, slapdash though. I'll not quite say violence, because violence is not right. It's, we're a robust comic. We, the Beano, I feel, tends to be a bit slicker. It's a bit,
highbrow.
Well, I wasn't going to say highbrow. No, it's there's a different audience. There's two...
There are more softies in it.
There's more softies, yes. There's not many softies read the Dandy. But, certainly not the ones that write to us anyway. They seem to quite like the biffs and the bangs and whatnot.
The knobs can be tough when they try, but not so tough as Dan's cow pie. Desperate Dan. Notice, grand dinner tonight at the Swanko de Posh Club. Admission $50. Desperate Dan. I guess I'll go to this. I could do with a feed. Reckon I'd better take along a cow pie to dinner in case there isn't enough grub to go round. Wish we could go to the feast for hunger. Well, you can take a bite out of my cow pie. Oh, thanks, Dan. My, it's hard as a brick. There's a sort of moral universe in the Dandy and the Beano, which is all very subtly different from the moral universe that we actually inhabit. They're all characters who are against the system and trying to exploit the system, aren't they? Partly because they're hungry. The great reward in these papers always is a feed. Whether you're human or an animal, you get a feed at the end. There's bangers and mash, always arranged in a particular way in these comics. The sausages are sort of penetrate the mash in a very violent way, to stick out. I don't think there's any Freudian significance. I think they just, that's the way they are. There are cakes, aren't there, sometimes? Particularly in the boarding school stories, in Winter Watson and the Dandy, which is a different world, that's harking back, really, to the world of Billy Bunter and almost First World War school stories. Corky the Cat always has his fish, of course, if he's lucky, which I always liked very much. It was a sort of a whole fish, usually a flat fish. He'd eat it like that and then it would turn into a perfect skeleton. Perfectly made, there'd be no bones scattered about, it would all be clinging to the vertebrae. To me, the essence of a Beano or Dandy hero is that you approve of them when they're storing off the grown-ups, or in case of Courtney, the human beings. And their tricks, although they're labelled as naughty, we know that in our hearts they aren't actually naughty. There's nothing morally wrong with them. They're funny. Well, the strange thing about the Beano and the Dandy is that I suppose they had their origins in 1930s Dundee, and then went all over the place in this bizarre and surreal way. But in lots of ways, they're still fixed in the 1930s of Dundee, with the whole world in which people eat pies and feel hungry all the time.
In faraway Venice lives a young man who drives every pretty girl crazy. He's got more technique than the best movie chic, but believe me, this fellow's not lazy. At 9 in the evening, he starts with a blonde. By 10, he has got a brunette. At midnight, you'll see him with some ginger girl, and he teaches them all how to pet. Dennis, the menace from Venice, a gay gondolier with gold rings in his ear. He will sing you a song as he pushes along his gondola. Dennis, the menace from Venice, each pretty young girl on that old Grand Canal walks around with a grin when she's been riding in his gondola.
Well, in 1937, it was felt that there was a place on the market for a comic. We hadn't got into comics at that time. So they took Albert Barnes off the Hotspur, that's where his chief sub, and asked them to produce a comic, which was The Dandy, and it came out in December of 1937. And it was a success, so that the directors thought they could put a companion paper on the market almost immediately, and I was taken off the Hotspur and the Wizard at that time and asked to produce the Beano. And it came out in July 1938. It was the biggest paper, 28 pages, with very little cost. It only cost 2D in old money. And there was quite a mix of cartoons and dramatic picture stories, and also the written story, the prose story, which of course has gone out of fashion these days. Unfortunately, has been going right through from the beginning.
He's quite a strange character, really, isn't he? He's not like any of the other characters.
He's the character that every reader wanted to be. I mean, to be a young lord who had a lot of money and everything at his fingertips, a Rolls Royce, a big house, a banister for sliding down, butlers and footmen and all that kind of thing. It was a great background for story material. And then, of course, over the wall was the gasworks and the gasworks gang. And also a lot of kids that Lord Snooty wanted to mix with. So that we had the clash of the good and the bad.
He lives in Bunkerton Castle, and I think, well, he's just a very cheerful type. And he looks as if he's rather posh, but I don't think he is that posh.
How does he speak?
Well, I think his people all are like this, yeah. And I think, well, I don't think he's one of those posh people who are always telling you to go away. You know.
You think he's not?
Yeah, I think he'd be a very nice fellow if he was real.
Lord Snooty always interested me very much. I didn't understand then, and I understand even less now, who he's meant to be, what sort of a person he's meant to be. I think he's one of those wonderful Beano or Dandy characters who just exists in the mind of his creator and then in the world of the reader. But, I mean, he comes apparently from perhaps American film version of Little Lord Fauntleroy, does he? With his Eton collar and his top hat. But all his friends, his chums, just seem like ordinary Bash Street characters. Though there are the odd, again, completely bizarre characters, a little Negro from the deep south of the United States, often in tow, sometimes with a hair in curlers. And Lord Snooty's mother and the women folk look like Whistler's mother in the painting. They're not like people you would ever actually meet. I'm interested, looking over the years at Lord Snooty, how when I used to read him first, he was more or less a carbon copy of Little Lord Fauntleroy, only without the curls, and he had straight little trousers. I'm not sure he didn't even have breeches at one point. His modernisation has happened very, very, very gradually. By about now, we're in 1987, and I should think his trousers have reached about 1962 or 3. There's a sort of flare in them, which is rather interesting. And I suppose if they survive another 50 years, he might be... I don't know, he might become a punk.
Well, this is the dandy office. Come inside and I'll introduce you to my staff.
Hi, I'm Breonna McMillan. I'm the dandy balloonist. I do all the balloon work and colour work for the magazine.
Hello, I'm John Methven, chief sub-editor and Desperate Dan scriptwriter.
Hi there, I'm Jim McKenzie, comic genius, and I write such great characters as Cuddles and Dimples and the Jocks and Geordies.
Hi, I'm Ian McLaughlin. I'm not quite as much of a genius as Jim, and I write the scripts for Cocky the Cat and Strange Help.
Welcome to the Beano office. Come in and meet the staff.
I'm John Kemp. I write Minnie the Minx, Ball Boy, The Germs, Gnasher and Nipper, and Rasher.
Hello, I'm Uncle Al, the kiddies' pal. I write Dennis the Menace, Roger the Dodger, the Bus Street Kids, and Ivy the Terrible.
Hello, I'm George Cobb. I write Calamity James, Billy Whiz, Cratch Sid, and Pup Parade.
I'm Craig Ferguson. I write Little Monkey, Number 13, Lord Snooty, and Handle the Letters Page.
To some extent, the Beano was a development of the dandy. Always a great deal of argument in those days, and I think still is, whether comics are a healthy influence or not. I had friends whose parents would not allow them to read these things, and therefore they got my black market copies smuggled and read in secret. The dandy came from that tradition. I mean, the Thompson tradition in terms of its magazines, particularly of its children's magazines, but it's true, I think, right through its publications, is a rather sort of wholesome, conservative, working class, rather folksy tradition. There was a brilliant series of artists associated with the dandy in those early days. And then, of course, there was the giant amongst them, undoubtedly, that remarkable figure, Dudley Watkins. He had already made his reputation, rather surprisingly, as a portrayer of Scottish comic character in the DC Thompson Sunday Post. There were two full-page cartoons there that still exist, one about a small boy called Urwully, and the other about a Scottish working-class family called the Bruins. On the basis of that skill, he then developed Desperate Dan, and then when the Beano came along, he developed Lord Snooty.
What kind of person was Dudley Watkins?
He was a strange person. He was a very nice person to deal with. He belonged to some obscure fundamentalist religious group and adhered to that very assiduously. He was absolutely prolific with his pen. It was, one of his assets for a publishing firm, that his output per week was very large in volume and remained high in comic quality.
I originated the character and worked with the original artist, Dudley Watkins, in producing him. The face it presented difficulties to begin with. I wanted something that was quite unique, and eventually thought of a caricature of myself, which had been done by another artist previously, which featured me with a big chin. So I got Watty to draw pictures of a cowboy with a big chin, and then with a pencil I squared off the chin and told Watty, I want a face with a chin like a chest of drawers. And that's how the typical Desperate Dan chin evolved.
I don't think people identify with Desperate Dan, because he's one of those enormous characters who's been occurring in literature ever since it began, rather like Samson in the Bible, isn't he? Who can perform extraordinary feats. Or Beowulf, in the earliest English literature. I mean, he's much bigger than everybody else. He seems to have his origins in American films. Just as the kids themselves, presumably, have their origins in the back streets of Dundee. So presumably, Desperate Dan and Little Plum have their origins in the Flea Pit cinemas, where they've been watching cowboy films. And at the same time, there's something surreal about Desperate Dan, because he isn't exactly an American cowboy.
Desperate Dan's horse breaks down. If it fails its MOT, Dan can catch a London cab. There's double-decker buses that run in Texas, but they run through the desert and they arrive at the docks, you know, they arrive at the seaside.
Texas.
And, you know, they go past our telephone boxes, our post boxes. But then also on the route to probably the US mail depot, you know, where the stagecoach stops and whatnot. Marvellous.
The town teacher wears a mortarboard and gown.
That's right.
Some police characters will.
Just a deck of cards and a jug of wine and a woman's lies make a life like mine. The day we met, I went astray, started going down that lost highway. I'm a rolling stone, all alone and lost, for a life of sin, I've made the call. I'm too far gone, too late to pray. Started going down that lost highway.
The endearing feature of Dan, always to me, is that Dan never means wrong. He never means to be bad. It's just, it happens. He's a big clumsy man and his strength gets in the road sometimes. But basically, he's a kid at heart.
Well, Desperate Dan has pies, doesn't he? And his children, the nephew and niece, have these pies. And sometimes porridge through a hose pipe. Do you remember his giving the breakfast with sort of these pies. I was very old before I went to Scotland. I suppose I was 15 or 16 before I ever went north of the border, so I'd never actually seen one of these Desperate Dan pies. A little hole in their consistency of dead human flesh. I don't know if you've ever seen one. They're horrible sort of things, completely without colour or life, and it's a kind of shininess to them. And inside is God knows what, bits of gristle and vegetables. I suppose they're a bit like a Cornish pasty, aren't they? Scottish equivalent.
Certainly one of the ingredients is this owl hoot juice that is a drink that comes from Cactusville. It's obviously a soft drink that Dan and the Cactusville residents brew up. And this gives them a lot of strength, the owl hoot juice. And it's certainly an ingredient in cow pie. But Aunt Aggie is the only one that really can make a cow pie. You know, she is the master. That's why Dan loves his auntie so much. She has mastered cow pie.
I once saw a cross-section of a cow pie and it was full of bones and hooves and old tails and the most awful waste.
Should remove the tail. That's an essential part of making a cow pie. That was obviously an amateur.
Wasn't that one of Aunt Aggie's best? I mean, really, she's quite careful.
The tail dangles from the back of the pie and is never included in the actual filling.
Good characters in the Beano at that time, Addy and Hermy.
And Mussolini.
Yes.
Beano.
They were debunked, really. I mean, I can remember one classic Musso where generals complained that the troops had run out of leather for shoelaces. So he commanded that all the boots be laced with spaghetti. And of course, they did the goose step march past Mussolini, all the boots flew off and he disappeared under a pile of boots. So that was the kind of humour.
Somebody in high places in D.C. Thompson felt that if the Nazis invaded, it would still be necessary to provide the nation's children with their dandy while the resistance was being fought. So I was sent off with another colleague to Glasgow, to the printing works that D.C. Thompson used there for the Sunday Post, to run a pilot project to prove that, if necessary, we could go on producing the dandy in the west of Scotland while the east of Scotland was under German occupation.
Come on, girls. Come on, chaps. Dot Hitler on the napper. Save up all your little scraps and be a paper scrapper. Well, it was a time of rationing, of course, and I suppose as a child, the sweet rationing hit hardest of all. And then there was paper shortages, which meant, of course, that the Beano and the Dandy were cut to about 12 pages, came out on alternate weeks. One was encouraged to collect waste paper, but we always assumed that the Beano and the Dandy didn't come into that category. They were exempt.
How long were you editor of the Dandy for?
I can't remember now, but I think probably 6 months, something like that. And then I went off to the war to join the Air Force, and I didn't come back after the war. Albert Barnes, as I've said, came back, carried on, and was undoubtedly a great children's paper editor.
And why didn't you go back?
Well, I didn't go back for personal reasons. D.C. Thompson are an idiosyncratic firm. For a very long time, they'd had a very non-union tradition, went back to the 1926 strike. Extraordinary firm, D.C. Thompson. In the 20s, one of my predecessors as Member of Parliament for Dundee was Winston Churchill. In fact, I'm the only person who served longer in Parliament for Dundee than Winston, who was there for 15 years. And he ended up in a spectacular quarrel with D.C. Thompson himself, the old man. They were both very strong personalities. It ended up with D.C. Thompson declaring that Churchill's name should be banned from the Thompson publications. And for a whole generation, really, in that interwar period, Winston Churchill's name was on the blacklist. They're that sort of firm, a very strong eccentricities, to put it mildly.
This is Jim Innes, Radio J News.
A very good morning to you. 3 minutes after nine. Thank you very much indeed, James, for the news and the weather and all that stuff. It's Ali Bally with you through until 12 midday, the mid-morning show. Starting off today.
Can you describe a typical working day? What happens? Then you go. What time do you go to work?
Right on time every morning. 9:15. You must get yourself in a relaxed frame of mind for our job. So we normally scan the papers. You could well pick up an interesting story that really lends itself to the script. Then we have, with apologies to our tea ladies, the worst cup of tea in the world, which kind of startles you into some kind of activity, and then the day just starts from there.
And then what happens?
You must think about a script. Most days you must then think about a script. We have so many to do, so many. Every week we have this, a comic to produce. Each of us have a... So there's never a day goes by but you must think on a script. And we do bounce, you know, we bounce ideas off each other. That's the way it is. You may pick something up in the paper or something you've seen going to work quite often.
Yeah.
And bounce it around. And a script slowly forms. Monday being a especially bad day. Yes. Very few scripts on a Monday.
Congratulations on the 50th anniversary of the Dandy and the Beano. These must be among the world's most famous and most loved comics. Over the years, they have given enjoyment to countless numbers of children, and the characters in their pages, such as Desperate Dan and Minnie the Minx, have become household names. I very much hope that both comics will continue to delight boys and girls for another 50 years. Margaret Thatcher.
Black Bob, the dandy wonder dog. Black Bob, the champion sheepdog, was helping in the training of Jack Grant, the boy who wanted to be a farmer. Jack set to work with a sledgehammer. Jack cut through the wire with a big axe. He meant to use part of the old fence as a ladder to reach the sheep. And now it saved his life by checking his fall. Bob landed on a fence post, his weight making the ladder swing across the cliff face towards a bush. Jack seized it and pulled himself onto a ledge. What excitement.
Well, at the time, in the late 40s and early 50s, that were the only two comics I had. They used to come through the door every week. What I liked about it was in the late 40s and 50s was fairly austere time. So I used to love the feasts, you know, with Lord Snooty, and my mum's a fairly organised lady. We used to have to sit up at the table with a knife and fork. And when she went away, on occasion she went away with my father, we used to set up a Beano feast. We used to have all the potatoes stashed up like that with the sausages in the top. It was great. I also liked, I liked Black Bob. I used to live in the country, and you know, in the late 40s, I actually wanted to be Black Bob. You know, I used to spend all day out in the countryside being Black Bob.
You didn't want to be his master. You just wanted to be Black Bob.
Yeah, it says something about me. Your mum and dad never, ever thought the Dandy or the Beano was good for you. But they did think the Eagle was good for you. And it was a kind of a bit of a middle-class imposition. I didn't like the back page, you know, how to be like John the Baptist or Winston Churchill. If I objected strongly. I liked the fact they were drawn well. I was attracted by Dan Dare, and I used to love the cutaways in the middle of the ships and things like that. But apart from Harris Tweed, it was the only one that I really liked, and I thought it was an imposition. That, have you read your Eagle yet? It's not the right way to have comics, you know. With the Dandy and the Beano in the lavatory or in your room, you know. So.
What's
Dennis
like?
Well,
he's a bit of a menace, really. And just likes going around and menacing softies like Walter and all them lot.
Does he have any pets?
Yeah, he has a dog called Nasha who helps him menace.
The dramatic change came about in the 50s. And I think the introduction of Dennis the Menace really started that. You had a small boy whom I think readers identified with. And he was just a bundle of mischief. From Dennis then came Minnie the Minx, the Bass Street Kids, Roger the Dodger, Jonah, and most of these characters, in fact, form the backbone or the core of the Beano as it is today.
It was very much the comic that the child wanted, him or herself, rather than the comic which a grown-up would buy for you. The idea was, particularly when you were gripped by the whole fantasy world of Dennis and Minnie and so on, was that the grown-ups were essentially disapproving, hostile figures, and that you were in this marvellous anarchic world. I think it's funny looking back on it now, because my children went through their Dandy and Beano phase, so I started to read it again when I was a bit older. And I realised when I was reading Dennis the Menace at the age of 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, I identified with him totally. And if you're grown up, or alleged grown up, reading the Dennis stuff, you can't identify with him anymore. He just seems like a charmless prat, really.
Dennis, how's Natalie? Mind your own business. Oh,
one
joke. Leather's
a fiver.
Oh, come on. No. Well, give it back. No.
Look.
Well, if you're going to give it back, what's the point of giving it to you in the first place?
Because I'm going to spend it, aren't I?
Yes, but if you're going to give it back, how can I give it?
Just be quiet.
Dennis is, strangely enough, quite a hard one to write. People find certain stories... Mm-hmm. You, I remember, found Bar Street hard to write.
No, I really agree with you. I find Bar Street easier than Dennis. Dennis is quite a tricky character to do.
Why?
Well, because in a... Although he is the hero of the strip, it's an odd one. Walter's funny. Walter's a very funny character. Dennis is the hero. You've got to keep that balance.
Well, Walter, for instance, he goes around picking flowers and paints his bedroom pink, and he exaggerates things. And it's nobody could, no self-respecting boy could put up with such a thing. I think that's why Dennis is so popular, because...
And he tells.
He does. He's a sneak. I mean, he's a thoroughly bad lot.
When he sees Dennis approaching, he says, "I'll tell."
And Walter's idea of a good evening is to settle down with a book of hard sums.
The Dandy and the Beano was, I mean, totally British, completely class-ridden. You mustn't be a swat or a swank or stuck up or a toff, or you were instantly punished.
Why do you think it is that Walter always has to suffer at the end if he seems to be a better person than Dennis?
Because the British are the Philistines. They don't like people that are too earnest or too keen or too clever.
Well, back
too,
in
clever,
comic,
too clever by half. Right?
Back in comic terms, I mean, Walter is the swat, isn't he? He's the school, he's the bookworm, he's the mummy's boy. He's everything that you're not meant to be as a kid.
And probably a prefect.
Well, I wouldn't say I admired Walter the Softy, but you can see, reading the stuff now, that Dennis's vision of Walter is what you're being given, not an actual person. Most of us will be Walter the Softy as seen by Dennis the Menace. And, of course, there's nothing admirable about them, really, but we all know that they're the people that are actually more interesting to know in real life. Talk about poetry or films or whatever it might be. Pathetic, weedy stuff like that.
I still get them every week now, and I read them both.
Did
Did you buy them yourself, or was it something that your parents bought?
No, I bought them myself. Yeah, got my pocket money. I can't remember how much that was. It wasn't very much. Most of it went on the comics and a little bit on sweets.
And did your mum and dad disapprove of you reading them?
No, they didn't. I don't think they sort of even thought about it. You know, they don't even disapprove of it now. I'm still doing it. But what did happen was when I was about, about 19, I'd got a real good bunch of them, and the annuals and the comics and the whole lot. And I left them at home, and my mom did chuck them away, which was really sad, because, you know, you're ending up going out and spending £5 and more for this thing that you were paying tuppence for, which was a shame, but there you go.
Did you have any particular favourite characters?
I like Minnie. I don't, you know, I mean, Minnie's really sort of got a bit of subtlety, isn't she? Yeah, she's definitely a nice person.
George Mooney has always said the view of a children's playground from this window gave him the initial inspiration for the series that finally became the Bass Street Kids. Initially, of course, it was entitled When the Bell Rings. Rather much when the clock strikes four, out they pour, and you obviously got considerable inspiration from just looking at the kids dashing around the playground.
I mean, there's a great war going on between the pupils and the teacher. And the pupils don't always win, that's the great thing. And the teacher wins occasionally.
Much to his surprise.
But it's so daft, it's so... it's good, it really is good stuff. My grandson loves it. He puts his nose in the book and he's sold on that strip for almost a day.
The last time I spoke to you, you didn't really approve of children being naughty too much.
Being shown to be naughty. But then there is a punishment. There is a moral. And they don't get away with it. I mean, if they do something really naughty, then there must be punishment. And kids appreciate that, I think.
Well, if you were an extremely naughty child, you inevitably got whacked, you know, so the whackings were... What I couldn't understand about the whackings was why, in the comics, you always got beaten on the bottom at school, because at the school I went to, I mean, you had the stick endlessly. I mean, I used to get the stick for saying hello instead of yes, sir, when they called the register. So that happened every holiday. But you used to get a cane on your hand. If they're feeling particularly nasty, they'd bring the cane up under your hand like that, which is even more painful. But you were never asked to bend over. And I think that must come from our class system, like the public schools, like the other comics, when you got a bit older, that you read were full of Billy Bunter and Harry Wharton, and they were always at some public school where you got beaten on the bottom. And it must have just filtered down into the other comics. But that was always a mystery to me, why you had to...
It also comes down to the fact that, you know, being beaten on the hand in a comic is not very funny, whereas in this country, in a British culture, being beaten on the bottom is hilarious.
Well, but we have discovered from our show that bottom humour, it seems to be universal, well, unique to this country.
Wackies! At in! Halt! About down! One pace step forward, march! Over, bend! Yes, I thought that would shake you all. I'm using the great new detergent, the five-seater model. Beats as it sweeps, as it hurts. Out a bit, number two. Steady, number one. Out a bit, number three. Number four, out a bit. Little bit more. In, see. Number five, out a bit. Are you receiving me, number five? Ow! Yes, Roger.
Corporal punishment is one of those strange things which, while it was going on...
Hey, you're never seen to
very, very few people seem to question it. I feel, but I may be deceiving myself, that while it was going on to me in my prep school, I always knew it was wrong. I always knew there was something creepy and strange about the idea of a man hitting children with sticks, because they'd done things which he considered to be wrong. But I'm probably rewriting history when I think that. And most people thought there was no harm in it whatsoever, and it's rather like fur trading now. It's only when a few cranks get up and say this is wrong that everybody suddenly changes their mind and sees that it is wrong, and that's the end of the matter. It becomes morally impossible thereafter to do it. I now think of it as absolutely abhorrent. And if somebody hit one of my children with a stick, I'd ring out the police. But strangely enough, they managed to read the Beano and the Dandy, and I don't think it's any more real to them than Greeks and Trojans killing each other if they read the Iliad. It's just one of those strange things which happens, and one knows that one of the hazards you're avoiding if you're Minnie the Minx or Dennis the Menace is being hit by the slipper.
The caning, well, I used to get caned at school. I never got caned at school, but it used to happen in my school. You know, I used to see the lads all lined up waiting to be caned, especially this one guy who drank. And that was just, you know, he was only 11. You know, used to see him getting lined up to get caned, yeah.
What did he drink?
Well, his dad had a pub, and he used to bring bottles of beer to school. And he ended up getting expelled, actually, because they couldn't cope with the drinking. But, used to see that. That was all right.
You talking?
It's not all right to drink. It was just the caning was all right. You know, the caning was just part of the day, really.
We're not talking about violence to real children. We're talking about violence committed in a silly drawing. It's just not the same thing. And kids aren't stupid. They know that. They know what happens in the Beano and the Dandy isn't real, and it's not like real life. It's one of the reasons for reading it.
Righto, Patrick. Yes. Look at the letters on the board for me. I'm going to cover that eye. That's right. Look at the big X at the top there for me. Look at the legs. That's right. What's the next letter down?
H.
Good. Well done. Now we'll have... There we are. Keep looking at the top.
At the time, I read somewhere that children had powerful eyeballs, 16 times more powerful than adults. I had no idea whether that was true or not, but certainly they were powerful because they never missed anything. And I could put a tiny microscopic little extra gag in a corner and they would write in about it. In Bash Street, I portrayed teacher as ineffectual. He could never master the kids. And yet in cartoon terms, he had to be a strong character. He had to be a strong presence on the page. And I made him very tall, very bony, very thin. I gave him weight. And I used archaic symbols like the mortarboard and his black trousers, black mortarboard, were sort of solid blacks. And I surrounded him with little artifacts that would bring the attention to him in one set in 1961, the circus set, where he's being trundled off in his car by the kids to the circus and he's passing his own house. There's his wife in the window looking remarkably like teacher with the moustache and so on. There's the homework books piled up in the dustbin, lots of other detail, that kind of stuff. So I was always bringing attention to teacher. When the child bought the Beano with its twopence, and this was one of the things about the Beano as compared with books, was accessibility. A child could afford twopence. The crucial thing was that it became the child's property. The individual copy became the child's property. It could come back to it again and again in the privacy of its own bedroom. And that's why it could spend the time going back again and again and looking, searching for little gags it had missed the first time and savouring the faces.
I mean, I do like the Bash Street kids, especially because the sort of sheer busyness of it, all the things that were going on in it. There was always another thing to look at, always a lot going on in the background. I've always been somebody who, when they read a comic, will sort of, I won't just pick it up and read it like that, I'll sort of go in like that, and I'll sort of go into it close, and I'll just, you know, just devour it. you know, my eyes would just rove over it, and I would just all the time be looking over it and over it. I'll read the story, you know, that's the... But then you go back over it and over it again and again. And for me, that's what, you know, reading the comic's about, really. They're centred on the children themselves, like the Bastard Kids are the heroes. Really, the mix is the heroes from their viewpoint. I did the strip was 30 years on, and it was just sort of taking it to its logical conclusion, just imagining what sort of people they'd be now. Toots and Minnie had sort of shacked up together after Toots' failed marriage to Plug. It was just sort of daft ideas, yeah. They'd be my sort of age group. And like Plug was a rock star. And Danny was bald, of course. You know, he was like the sort of the impresario type. Sort of,
yeah. When you're writing scripts, you must never be childish, but you always have to be childlike. And this is the way you have to think. You have to put yourself in the place of the child.
They've got me beat, I just can't make it out. Just can't understand it at all. The market's down 4 points.
It's got me beat as well. Desperate Dan's just eaten 4 car pies and he's still hungry.
And they're still probably the best weeklies appearing in this country, aren't they? If you compare them with some of the falling rubbish that's comes out of London, Punch or the New Statesman or the Spectator. Then even on a poor week, the Dandy does well.
And I'm inclined to say, and it's only half jocularly, that, you know, in a long and varied and interesting life, I really was rather more sure at the end of a working week on the Dandy comic that I'd added to the sum total of human happiness than I've ever been quite sure as a cabinet minister or a European commissioner or as chairman of the IBA.
Good night, Jim.
Good night, Alan.
Good night, Euan.
Night, Morris. And good night, children, everywhere.